As a fan in need of a much bigger fan on a day like this, I do wish the Mudcats were as sizzling as the weather. But they don't call them the boys of summer for nothing. Hey, it's going to be a long, fun, who knows what's going to happen the rest of the season. And downpours follow droughts. Sweat and smiles go hand in hand. And all in all, the forecast for the rest of 2016 looks just like today, bright and sunny. To wrap up the first half of the season and to wave in the second half of the season like we need today, we're going to stick with the thermometer theme. We're going to look at some hot topics concerning the team. We're also going to talk with heat throwing closer Chase Johnson Mullins. And then we're going to visit hot corner player Jordan Edgerton at third base. And then we're going to meet a blistering Zeppelin Batman named Spencer Brickhouse, who blazed the trail to East Carolina with a scorching, absolutely scorching statistical career at Bunn High School right down the road. I think you're going to enjoy meeting him. I think you're going to enjoy his numbers are going to wow you. And I hope you have a good time on this episode. So let's, just like it is at Five County Stadium Day, let's start cooking.
Here's the pitch. Meneses swings and drills one right back up the middle. It's across the mound and into center field for a hit. Up to third and coming in is Obregon. The throw goes to third. Curcio's over there. He can do it. The pitch swung at a flare, hitting the shallow left. Coming in a long way, Curcio goes into a dive. Backhand catch. He got it. His throw goes to second. Double play. That ends the inning. And that is the play of the year. Outstanding grab by Keith Curcio.
I'm standing here with closer Chase Johnson Mullins. I read that you grew up on a cattle farm, but nobody has to ask you where the beef is. It's in that left arm of yours and all 6'9" of you.
Yes, sir.
So in Kentucky, Bourbon County High School?
Yes, sir. Bourbon County High School in Bourbon County, Kentucky.
All right, now let's talk about your last month. You went a month without giving up a run. 7 appearances over 8 innings. I know you got tagged for just one last night,
yes,
but I mean, it's still.
Yeah.
And you get stuck with the loss because you always inherit runners and stuff like that. So how do you feel like your season's going?
I feel like it's going well. I'm learning a lot more, you know, each and every out, and then I go out there. You know, I've always got feedback from, you know, my pitching coach and
right. Manager
and even some teammates. So it's been a really fun experience. I'm having a lot of fun, learning a lot, and playing with some good guys.
Now, that fastball.
Mm-hmm.
You start with an upper 90s fastball. Tell me and tell the viewers, what's a two-seam fastball supposed to do?
For a left-hander against a right-hander, a two-seam fastball is supposed to move down and away from the swing path of the right-handed hitter.
Okay.
So, left-handers have the natural movement. It's
right. Unexplainable,
but we've got it. So, blessed with the left-handed arm and the two-seam movement.
Look, and I know pro scouts and everybody love that, and that's why you're ranked so high. Everybody's got such great expectations for you. Now I know you like to go with that fastball, and I know you like to once you get ahead, you like to throw that curve in the dirt.
Mm-hmm.
Now while you were having a trouble before May 15th, you had 5 outings, you gave up 8 runs. What did you see as the problem during that spell?
Consistency, repeating my mechanics, getting ahead in the count, and then executing the off-speed. I mean, it was all about getting the first pitch strike for me because I'm such a feel-type pitcher. A lot of pitchers go off of, you know, the situation at hand. I'm such a go-off-the-feel type, and get that first pitch strike is so key for me to work in that curveball in the dirt or bust a fastball inside. And,
right. You
know, but it was obvious that I had to change something up, and that's when I got with Derek Lewis, and we got to work.
Mm-hmm. Now, like I said, for the last month, you didn't even give up a run. So what was going right?
Everything, really. I mean, I felt great. Body, you know, I prepared myself the way I needed to, and I threw to my defense. I threw ground balls, and I trusted the guys behind me, and I let them work.
Now, I think it's Shelton State Community College. You were a starter. 4-1 had 10 starts, 12 games. What was the big adjustment to all of a sudden coming out of the bullpen?
Well, actually last year in Danville was my first year as a reliever ever, and it was different because I've been a starter my whole life.
Right.
But it's mentally it's a different ball game.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you're jacked up. you're called on in the ninth inning with three outs to go and two runs. I mean, you're ready to shut the door. It's different, but I love it personally. I mean, it's my type of game.
So it's like kind of like wow thing in Major League.
Yeah.
I mean, you're geared up when you come in. Yeah, you come in.
Absolutely. Yeah. You're throwing in the bullpen as soon as you jog on that mound. You're running straight off adrenaline.
Now you inherit, like I said, you inherit a lot of runners, so you don't have time to mess around. You have to come in there and start throwing strikes.
Absolutely, and that I feel like that's a reliever's job. Period. Mm-hmm. You know, starters got 6-7 innings to work, which they should. You know, they got great. Our starters here got great stuff. And you know, our relievers got to come in immediately and bust the zone, challenge hitters, and trust their defense from the get-go.
Mm-hmm. Now you're tied with Evan Phillips for 7 saves. Do you feel like you're finding your groove now?
I feel like I'm everything's running on all cylinders right now. I feel like I found my rhythm, but Evan's a tough guy to keep up with.
I got you. Now you got your own sight set. I read that your favorite player was Randy Johnson.
Absolutely.
So I mean, you obviously you got a lot. I like Randy Johnson. Is that why? Were you always so much bigger? I mean,
I've always been a bigger kid. I never was the biggest until about sophomore year of high school, but I was always a big kid.
Mm-hmm.
And just to see, it wasn't even the size that I loved about him. It was just he was a bulldog on the mound. He was such a competitor. He went out there and competed every night, and he was just a fun pitcher to watch. And
now, when did you hit 90 for the first time? Do you remember what age you were?
I was a sophomore in high school. I was 15 years old. It was the summer of my sophomore year, and I had just committed to the University of Kentucky.
Right.
And I hit 90 for the first time.
Now, could you tell by the smack on the mitt that, hey, listen, that was a lot faster than I've thrown before?
Well, really, it was a little awkward in high school because when I tried to throw hard, it would only be 85, 87. But the days that everything was just felt smooth and I got extension and busted hitters in, that's when they were like, you hit 90 like 4 times today. Really, I didn't even throw hard. I didn't try to throw hard today. That's usually when it happens.
Well, we got the movie The Rookie when he didn't know he was throwing that fast.
Absolutely. When you throw your hardest, you really don't feel it.
Right. Going into the second half of the season, you feel ready? I mean, you feel like this team can make a move, make a run.
Absolutely. We got a good group of guys that when we're on, we are tough to beat.
Right.
We got a great bullpen. Very deep bullpen. We have some really good starters that give our team a chance to be in the game at mm-hmm. all times.
Where would you like to be at the end of the season? I mean, what's going to make you happy?
You know, I just want to keep doing my job. I whenever they call on my name, I'd like to keep doing what I'm here to do, and it'll all take care of itself.
Yeah, well, I'm telling you, I'm standing right beside him, so I know how batters must feel when they go in because he is one intimidating force. Hey, thanks a lot,
buddy.
Chase.
Sir.
Hey,
yes,
have
sir.
A good season, buddy.
Thank you, sir.
Right-handed hitter in the pitch to him. Meneses swings and lines one into right field, base hit. Gaylor's up to third. He's coming in. This game is over. Joey Meneses wins it. The Mudcats take it 9-8. Meneses goes 4-for-5 today.
I'm standing here with Jordan Edgerton, third baseman, playing the hot corner. One of the toughest positions in all of baseball. He's a North Carolina native, came from Gastonia, South Point High, won a state championship right up the road at Duck Field, NC State. You're back in your home state. Take me through being a pro now, playing that hot corner. I mean, how tough is it to play that position?
I've been playing it my whole life, so it's definitely a little bit of adjustment in pro ball because, they're going to hit a little bit harder.
Right.
But that's one thing I've been happy with this year is my defense. It's mm-hmm. been one of the main things we wanted to improve on from last year, and I feel like I've done it so far, so we got to keep that rolling. But, it's just a privilege to be able to play in my home state in front of my family and friends. So, it's definitely a privilege.
Well, let me make you feel a little bit better, too. I have seen some places where you've been called maybe, possibly, the next Chipper Jones. Is that something when that you hear and you have to smile at something like that?
Yeah, I don't know who wrote that, but I don't know what they're looking at. But that's obviously an extreme compliment. But whether it's got any validity to it, I don't know. But it's definitely a compliment.
But let's talk about your errors have gone way down. And it was a knock on you for a couple of years there. Now you've had three errors all this season, like 110 chances. Your fielding percentage is 50 points, 60 points better than it has been the last two seasons. So you are improving that area.
Correct. Yeah, that's like I said, it was a big thing. I got together with Louis Lopez, our infield instructor, Nestor Perez in Rome last year, and it was really not a big adjustment we had to make. And but once you just got to get it in muscle memory and repeat it, and we made the adjustment, and I'm happy with that so far this year.
Right.
Just playing good defense. Just got to get back on track at the plate, and I think we'll be good.
Now, and one of the things I also read was that you will, if you're going to make it to the bigs, it's going to be as a third baseman. So it's not like they're going to be looking to shift you around, because you're made for that slot. And like you said, you've been playing your entire life. Let's go to that side of the plate. You went to UNC Pembroke, and you batted 392 as a sophomore, 369 as a junior. Only had 22. You had 22 walks and only 9 strikeouts your junior year at UNC Pembroke. We had talked a little bit earlier, and you had said maybe that has been a little bit of a problem this year, but you're improving on that.
Yeah, we're myself and Carlos Mendez are making some adjustments at the plate as far as two-strike approach, and it's been weird, especially on the mental side of things. You know, you getting a little funk, and you start pressing, and that's been the main problem. It wasn't really a swing problem early in the year, and I started pressing, and that's when it became a swing problem. So now we're getting back to where we started and making some adjustments and trusting the process, and hopefully it's going to start turning things in the right direction. We're not worried too much about the results right now. We're just worried about the process and keeping it going and trying not to worry too much about the outcome.
Right. Now, your average, you're not happy with your average, but you are on pace to break set career highs in every other category. You're second on the team in RBI with like 28. So you're doing the thing. And let me tell you something. Let me tell everybody at home. When it comes to driving in runs, this guy's uber when it comes up to bases loaded. He's batting .714 when he comes up with the bases full. So that pressure has not been pressure. How have you approached that?
I didn't even know that, but trying to get a pitch up in the zone. I can handle and get in the outfield, but I'm like you said, my average is down. I'm not happy with that. We got to get that back up. Got to get the strikeouts down, and when the strikeouts go down, you know the average is going to go up because you're putting the ball in play. Good stuff happens, but I like to take pride in driving in runs, and I'm actually, there's been a lot of runs out there that I haven't got in that have really, that gets to me more than,
more than
a lot of things, because, you know, that's what I'm supposed to excel in. So hopefully we can tone down this approach and get it good and get it back to where it was last year, early in the year before I got hurt, and just go from there.
You have been called next year by Jones. Everybody says that you could make your position at third base. I heard that you also said one time it'd be really cool to wear a tomahawk. So is that really just – would Atlanta be the place you'd really like to be?
Of course it would. I mean, I grew up being a Braves fan. So, that comparison to Chipper is maybe a little bit of a reach. But it's definitely a compliment. And, I obviously want to play in Atlanta one day. And hopefully we can get these adjustments down. And hopefully that'd be a stop in the future. So
now, I know you got to go and get ready, but tell me, what do y'all look for as a team for the second half of the season? You're down at the bottom of the standings right now, but you reboot the 0-0 come next Thursday. So are y'all really excited about the second half?
Yeah, I know a lot of the guys, we're excited about the All-Star break. I'm sure every professional baseball player in America is. But looking forward to going home, resetting, especially for myself, having a poor first half in my eyes. Go home, reset, try to start from zero, and I know the guys on the team want to do that, and hopefully we can make a little run in the second half and make the playoffs.
Sounds good. Hey, everybody, come on and hang and watch this guy. I expect him to go nothing but up, 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 because he's doing a great job at the corner right now. Thanks a lot, Jordan.
Thanks.
Hey, have a good night. Good luck.
Doing it in longer stretches. The pitch, he swings and hits one in the air to right. Pretty well struck. Suter drifting back on it. Over near the wall now. Suter jumps up and he missed it. It bounces off the base of the wall. Karam's out towards center. Meneses up to second, racing for third, and he's in there with a slide. He has a triple. first baseman who was holding the runner that's owed him at first had a home run in the fourth. Pitch here, swing and a drive. Deep right field. Suter going back. Look it up. Gone! Two-run home run, Braxton Davidson.
As it hits you yet, exactly where you're at in your young career, that you are, I mean, you're setting a tone for an entire area. We've never seen this in 15 years, 20 years.
To a certain point, yeah, it's hit me. Just knowing that, you know, what I've done has been pretty special. But, you know, to another extent, it's just baseball to me. I go out there and I play the game every day like I did when I was six, 7 years old. You know, the game hasn't changed, and I try to play the game. I try to make it as simple as possible. You know, run, hit, throw. I mean, you just try to keep the game as simple as possible. I mean, just don't try to overthink everything.
Now, set it from how long, when did you start? When's your first memory of playing baseball?
I probably started around 3-4 years old. And just from there, just kind of started with it. And
plastic bat?
Yep,
getting off a little plastic tee?
Yep, that's where it all started out. And my parents just tried to get me to try all sports. I tried football, basketball, baseball. And, I was decent at all three, but I just decided baseball was just a better fit for me.
I got you. Now, I know David Howe, the football coach at Bunn High School. You got past his grip. You're 6'3", 220 pounds. He could have used you as a tight end or defensive end or something. Did he ever come up and put it home and say, yeah, let's try football?
No, he never really did that. Coach Miller before him, he was there freshman year.
Exactly, I got you.
He tried to get me to play, but Coach Howe, he had a lot of respect for me. He kind of realized that I had a future in baseball. Mm-hmm. So he realized I could get hurt in football if I went out there. Just, you know, anything could happen. So he respected me more for that. And he tried to really help me out and kind of steered off. I had some friends that really wanted me to play.
Right. I'm sure with your size. Was there a point when somebody looked at you and said, "Hey, listen, Spencer, you're going to be a special player"? I mean, you're not your run-of-the-mill baseball player. Did anybody ever, any coach at any level ever tell you that?
Yes. I was probably 12, 13 years old. I started playing for a team out of Wilson, and that's when that coach told me. His name was Earl Taylor, and he told me that, you know, this guy he's got a good swing. Mm-hmm. You know, he's got a left-handed swing that I've never seen before. It's just a very unique swing, and I'm just very fluid. And so he really liked me, and then he got me to play for his team. And from there on out, he promoted me, and he really got me to where I am.
Mm-hmm. Now, coming up through rec ball, did you play rec ball in Zeblin, or did you play in Bunn, or where'd you play rec ball at?
I played Bunn. That's where all my friends were. I went to school in Bunn.
Right, exactly.
So I pretty much just grew up with all those guys, so I decided to stay.
Now, were you the terror of the league? Were you the guy that whenever he came up, everybody just said walk him or put him on? The coaches always said, put him on base, not let him hit.
No, that was never really me. I was never really much of a power hitter at a young age. I was more of a contact hitter. You know, I'd go up there, you know, I'd go whole seasons and strike out maybe twice.
Right.
And, you know, even at 7-8 years old. But I never really hit that many home runs.
Right.
So, you know, it was one of those things, everybody knew I was going to put a bat on the ball, but nobody ever thought I was going to hit it out. I really wasn't a tear. I was just kind of, you know, I was one of the better hitters, but I wasn't the best hitter. It was a good amount of guys at that age where we kind of stayed with each other hitting-wise.
When they told this guy he had room for improvement, if anybody ever did ever tell him that, he went out and built a hotel because he's pulled off something in high school that's very rare. He has set a career record for a season in a different category every year he played. For example, let me give it to you. In freshman year, 38 hits. 38 hits in 24 games. Sophomore year, he turns around 48 RBI. 48 RBI in 22 games is just astonishing. As a junior, poor guy comes up here and he hits 585 for the season with 31 runs, both of those career highs. And then his senior year, he tops it off. The only thing he does is he goes out and hits 13 home runs, 38 RBIs in 23 games. 13 home runs. You saved your best for last. Did you build on that momentum? Was that momentum building the whole time, or did you just pick something in the offseason and say, I need to work on this?
No, I really just kind of went into the season. In the offseason, I progressively got stronger. You know, freshman year, I wasn't as strong as sophomore year. Sophomore year, not as strong as junior year. And, you know, as I went in, of course, you know, I tried to stay within myself, like I said earlier. You know, freshman year, I wasn't that strong, so I didn't try to hit it out. All I tried to do was hit line drives, you know, in the gap somewhere, and that's how I had the hits. You know, sophomore year, I got the RBIs.
Right.
You know, the coach would put me in the third hole. The first and second batters were phenomenal at getting on base.
Right.
So it really helped me out. And, you know, senior year, I, you know, built up the strength, and I finally got strong enough where I can actually hit it out on a regular basis. And, you know, I could you know, I was still putting good, you know, good wood on it. Well, technically metal, but
yeah, which helps.
Yeah. But you know, but it was still, it was just finally flying like I, you know, I wanted it to be. And, you know, playing travel ball, that really, you know, it opened my eyes to seeing the better pitchers, and it helped me to adjust. So in my off season, I really got better at seeing pitches, knowing how to work a count, and getting the pitches that I want to see.
Now, college players get moved up faster.
Yep.
They move faster because they've already got that time. And Carlos Rodon, Holly Springs High School, 15th round coming out of high school, goes to state, spends 3 years, number three pick,
yep.
6.5, the largest signing bonus of that year at number three pick. So if Spencer Brickhouse ends up at ECU, it is not a failure.
No.
You have still got a couple of years down there, and they're going to see you. Now, you'll have to be in college for 3 years because you'll have to leave out of your junior year, but you'll have a chance to show these guys what you can really do.
Yeah, that's when I feel like I really showcase that I can hit off of, you know, faster pitching, you know, better off speed. I can hit better pitchers. And with Cliff Godwin, you know, being the best hitting coach in the nation,
right,
I feel like he can really tweak my swing to make me, you know, and I'm going to be working out, you know, hours a day just getting physically stronger and better. And he's going to make me a better prospect coming out 3 years. And, you know, some scouts have saying I could be the best power hitter in the next, you know, after 3 years. Just really coming out of college.
Again, thanks a lot for your time. You're a great guy. And everybody, pull for this guy because, I mean, you just gained your biggest fan. And I know there's a lot of other big fans out there, too. Thanks a lot, Spencer.
Yes, sir.
He's one for one. The infield now has moved back. Vanessa's ready from the right side. Two on in front of him. The pitch, he swings and lines one toward the corner. That is a fair ball, and it's off the wall. Both runs will score. Meneses on his way to second, and he's in there with a two-run double. The Mudcats have the lead 4-2. Odom is 0-3. He's in a seven-game hitting streak. Here's the pitch. Odom swings and lines it softly over the reach of the shortstop Rondon. It's a base hit. Gaylor's up to third. Rocket's going to send him. Ball picked up in center by Jones. Dropped. No throw. Gaylor scores. Odom extends the hitting streak, and he gets an RBI single.
As you can probably tell from my predicament, my message for this show is to hang in there. The season's only halfway over. It wraps up June 19th, but it resumes June 23rd. We'll be back. The Mudcats will be back. I appreciate all the guys who helped make the first part of the season so much fun. And I'll tell you, if you want to keep up with us, you want to send us some story ideas or give us some feedback, email me at don.fuller@eastwaketv.org, EWTV.org. You can visit our website at any time. And please feel free to check out our Facebook page. And please like it, because we're going through a lot of work here. Until the next episode, I'll be dropping by real soon.